Welcome to Nordic Metal Cruise 2020. Yes, it's a new decade and not so new bands. We have Dark Funeral here. Can you imagine that? Welcome. Please, sir, introduce yourself for the young audience here who might be totally clueless.
Well, my name is Elia Madra and I'm the singer of Dark Funeral.
You have been in the band quite a few years, but you're far away from being the, one of the original members. And yet Dark Funeral is quite an old band, even for Swedish terms of being one of the black metal originating countries. How has your trip been so far in the band during all these years?
Well, I joined the band almost 6 years ago now. It's been intense. We put out an album, been touring around the world, basically. And now we're working on album number two, with me on it, I mean.
So how has your life changed since you joined Dark Funeral? I mean, you're not the young guy exactly, you've been in the scene for a long time, so you had already your experience, but with Dark Funeral, surely something must have changed. Can you share any thoughts about it?
Well, of course, the clubs got bigger, festivals bigger, and everything from production and you know, level of professionalism when it comes to crew, well, everything, you know, stepping up the game, basically. And it's been really interesting to do that and to see that. And I still do this small club gigs with my other band also. So I get like the best of two worlds. So I like it.
Before we get more into the Dark Funeral, can you mention your other band? We talked about before starting the interview, but obviously the audience has no idea it. So can you briefly mention your other band and what is the main difference between that and Dark Funeral?
Well, I joined Dark Funeral when they had the 20th anniversary show in Stockholm. So they invited my other band Gra to be the support act for that. And I got in contact with the Dark Funeral guys. Turns out me and Ariman have like common friends from north of Sweden, which I also come from. So that's kind of how I came into Dark Funeral, because we got along and the Caligula was leaving. So it's like, okay, well, maybe we take it to the next step there. So yeah, that's basically how I ended up there. And I still keep Gra alive, and we're putting out albums, doing smaller tours, doing shows. We're going to England in May, for example. So, well, there I play guitar also. So I'm like the main songwriter and singer.
How is the performance when compared to Gra and Dark Funeral? How do they differ from your perspective?
Well, first of all, I have a guitar in my hand.
Yeah, obviously.
That makes everything quite different, of course.
But in the terms of like atmosphere and feeling?
Well, Dark Funeral is a really fast and aggressive band, whereas Gra is more like more atmospheric, more mid-pace, almost down to slow. So it's completely different in style, yet it's still in the same black metal concept which I am working in. So if it's me, I get the best from two worlds in a way.
What about the lyrics then? How much they differ from each other, in your opinion?
Well, Dark Funeral doesn't sing in Swedish, for example.
Yeah, but I mean the content. Are there like different topics? You have to have a different mindset and all that stuff.
Yeah, yes and no. I write differently, yes, but it's really hard to explain exactly how. First of all, most of the Gra lyrics are in Swedish. Mm-hmm. And the Dark Funeral lyrics are in English, so you, of course, you need to have a different mindset already there. And topic-wise, no, there's not a huge difference. No, I wouldn't say. I don't know. You kind of have to read them by yourself and make your own judgment on that. But if you can't read Swedish, it's kind of hard.
How hard was for you to fill the shoes of Caligula? I mean, he was already kind of a prominent figure in the black metal scene, especially in Sweden, and you had to kind of start filling those shoes. How did it happen?
Well, the thing is that people have asked me that many times, and I cannot feel. I mean, that guy is like this high. His shoes are too big. I have my own shoes, you know, so I fill my own shoes, and it's not about size. It's about me being myself. I cannot be like a Caligula replica or something like that. I had to do my own thing, to be honest, with myself and with the band and also with the fans. So I don't know. I think the reception have been really, really well from people, and maybe that's why, in a way, also because I'm a completely different person from Caligula. So of course it shows in stage, it shows in the lyrics, it shows in many ways.
Do you think you kind of renewed the sound of band when you joined? Do you think you made a difference than just being a new vocalist?
Well, like I said, the lyrics are different, I think. The last album that we put out, they are more introvert, I think, and maybe a bit more poetic rather than aggressive. So yeah, I think I had an influence in the end result of the album. Yes, I think so. In what way exactly is hard to say, but yeah, we do things differently, me and Caligula. Yeah.
Have you matured the band also?
I have matured myself a lot, but the band, I don't know. I mean, we're out doing what the band has been doing for 25 years, basically. Of course, hopefully better every time.
Audience sometimes complains that whenever a newer member comes into the band, they're always like complaining, like, okay, this is not the same band. This especially happens with older bands such as, like, you know, Sepultura, Metallica and the like, which are like, hey, I don't like the new guy. And the new guy's like, hey, I've been here like more years than those other guys combined.
Yeah.
Do you face these kind of challenges yourself? Are there people like, I cannot listen to that band anymore because it's not the same guys? Or are you like even more welcomed than the older fellas?
I don't know. I mean, even I don't like when bands change members. so of course...
There's a contradiction then.
Yeah, well, of course. But I mean, look at, for example, one of my favorite bands, Mayhem.
Mm-hmm.
Attila was vocalist number 3.
Mm-hmm.
And he's back now and he was totally... I mean, I'm also vocalist number 3 in Dark Funeral. So it depends on how you see it. I think it's about the performance, if you're actually adding something or if you just... You cannot be worse, if you know what I mean.
Mm-hmm.
But you don't have to be the same.
You have to have a kind of a step up.
Yes, I think you need to provide something that is a bit different, something a bit new, a bit of your own. And if you cannot do that, it will only be like a bad carbon copy. And you can see, you know, this is forgery, you know.
Yeah, it's just like doing the worst version of what it used to be.
Yeah, exactly. So, yeah, with that in mind, I've been listening to shit tons of Black Sabbath with Tony Martin on vocals lately. The Headless Cross album is amazing, for example.
Would you consider saying it's kind of a heresy to say that Ozzy is not really the best man, even though being the original?
I love the Ozzy albums also. But I mean, I love pretty much all of the vocalists that they have on all the albums. I mean, they're different, and that's why they're good. Of course, I understand that it doesn't appeal to everyone, but come on, it's good albums.
Exactly. So let's talk about Dark Funeral's ideology and philosophy. How do you see them? Could you describe them in a couple of sentences, maybe?
Anti-bullshit, anti-religion.
Dark Funeral has been always kind of like straightforward, very much mentioning Satanism or Satan in one sense or another, and then also having this really dark and kind of a sinister appeal. But there have also been kind of a flirting with like this kind of a dark mysterious topics and all that stuff with some of the lyrics. How do you think these kind of non-satanic topics, non-religious topics fit the band?
I think they are, in a way, still spiritual topics, if not like religious topics. You have spirituality in songs about a goddess, for example. You walk away from this typical Satan thing and go to something deeper, because you have all this. I mean, Scandinavia hasn't been a monotheistic country forever. We had shit tons of gods. The world have shit tons of gods, and some are good, some are bad, and depends on how you see it. So I think there is still a spirituality in it, which I have tried to keep also when I write the lyrics, to keep spirituality, not religion, but spirituality.
Dark Funeral is seen also as a second wave black metal band in general, after like many people know obviously which are the first bands, and so we don't have to kind of repeat them here, but we're also very much talking about third wave, and who knows whatever other waves there will be. What do you think? Dark Funeral has been kind of showcasing this like you said, satanic topics, and being the kind of a forerunners of the Swedish black metal since those times. But what do you think, how do you see these other bands which are changing the course, removing the spirituality from the equation, so to speak, and adding sometimes political nature or nature that are anyway at all spiritual, religious or otherwise?
I think every band needs to do what they want themselves. I mean, people evolve in different ways, and for me, when I was, you know, young teenager starting to listen to this whole extreme metal thing, everything was about being innovative. You know, nowadays it's about being conservative. A lot of things are conservative. While it was pioneering, how fast can we play? How fucking evil can we get, you know?
Exactly.
But now it's about preserving that. And I think a lot of the older bands still have the mentality of growing, to develop. I mean, a good example of a band I like, Enslaved. They had this super raw, they come from this super raw background. Now they're moving into something different.
Kind of a progressive.
Yeah, and I mean, they seem to fucking love what they're doing. You can show on stage, you can show on the albums, they love it. And even if I don't love everything, I totally respect the course, because you still have the roots there. I mean, you still can hear it's Enslaved, for example.
That is such a very good point, because whatever I read about, like on zines, or I read about or hear about comments and interviews, yeah. So many people say that metal has always been, and black metal particularly, has been about this rebellion. You have to rebel against, you know, the forces that powers may be,
yeah.
And also those kind of rules and regulations and whatever. But now it seems that the older we get here, older guys, say 40 plus, we seem to be very judgmental towards new styles, new genres of metal. So we kind of become the victims of our own mindset.
Yes.
And then we are like waving our fists towards the young guys, like, you're not supposed to play metal like that. And people are like, come on, you're exactly repeating. So
yeah, exactly.
What do you think about these new genres and subgenres, which are, you know, taking place of the older styles?
Well, I don't understand it necessarily, and I don't have to. I mean, I can still listen to my old albums,
mm-hmm.
But if people are doing what they want, and if people are evolving and making evolution happen, fucking go for it. I mean, we used to wipe our asses with leaves back in the day. We have paper now, you know? So, I mean, things evolve. Some people like the leaves still, but I don't know what to say. I mean, evolution, without evolution,
there's nothing?
There's no point. I mean, why repeat? Then it's just, basically becoming cover bands.
Which kind of bands you are inspired mostly these days? Whether it's about creating lyrics or creating songs, even single riffs, do you just stick with the older bands, or are you expanding the horizon, so to speak?
Well, I'm wearing a Judas Priest t-shirt now, for
example. Yeah, but it's an old band.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah, no, I listen to shit tons of old music, and I have done that recently. Well, like Judas Priest, mm-hmm. I've been listening to The Doors a lot. Creedence Clearwater Revival, you know, that mm-hmm. kind of shit that my dad used to listen to.
Mm-hmm.
When I grew up, I kind of went back to childhood in a way to start exploring that kind of...
Yeah, like what did you miss back in
yes,
the days?
Yes, and those were the fucking rebels back then.
Mm-hmm.
So I can still understand it. Like you say, we're getting to the age where the new stuff we cannot understand anymore, but we can understand old rebellion. And that's where we come from, and that's what we rebelled against. But in retrospect, was it that bad? No. It was fucking awesome, a lot of the things.
They had plenty of good ideas.
Yeah, exactly. And I mean, there wouldn't be blast beats without the evolution of things.
Yeah, one could even say that even bands like Blasphemy or Bathory couldn't exist without bands like Beatles.
Yeah.
Even though we feel like, hey, this is just some mainstream pop stuff.
Absolutely.
But every part, when you added a layer of new guitar sound or create new riff or melody or drum beats even, it made part of this... evolution.
Yeah.
But what do you think? What can you give to this evolution? Do you think you have put one rock or more into this big pile of what we could call pile of metal, maybe?
I think that will only be seen in the future if I have. I'm living in the now, so whatever I have contributed to, it will show in the future, when looking back, of course.
If there was a few bands, like, I don't know, three maybe, which you could refer as, like, if you do like these bands, then you should check Gra or Dark Funeral. Which bands would they be? Or in case you see them as important otherwise?
Well, one is enough, Bathory.
Do you think there's a lot of similarity between Bathory and Dark Funeral and Gra?
Yeah, I do, yeah.
All Swedish and black metal?
Yeah, and awesome.
Many people say that Norwegians basically created and mastered black metal, and everything since is just not that good. And that is very much in dispute and debated and whatever. What do you have to say to these people who are going to miss a lot of bands just because they are not Norwegian?
Well, Sweden used to own Finland. Sweden, you kind of own Norway for a while, and that should like say everything, right? Historically.
What about bands that are not Scandinavian origin? Some people say that you cannot have this black metal feeling and atmosphere if you're not from countries where cold winds breeze and chill your bones. But then again, we have places like Greece where there's own scene. We have South America where there's own scene. How do you see this whole beauty of extreme metal and black metal?
Well, I mean, one good example of a newer band, if you will, I really like the Polish Magua.
Mm-hmm.
Fucking awesome.
Great.
I love a lot of Greek bands too. I mean, I'm definitely not limited to where people come from. I don't give a shit. Because good music is good music, and the Greek scene has been great since like the early 90s.
Exactly.
And it's still awesome, actually. A lot of things happening there. So, total support for that. And that's, I think, the scene that I've been into most, apart from, you know, to be a bit more country oriented, because I play there a lot. So, yeah, well, I mean, it's awesome. If good music is coming from wherever, I don't care where. If it's good, it's good.
Many touring bands especially seem to say in interviews very often that they don't have the time to check out new bands because either they're touring all the time by themselves,
yeah,
and they don't have the time to experience new bands, maybe outside gigs and whatnot. What is your take on this? Do you have the time to explore new bands or just stick with the old ones?
Well, I try when I can, but it's kind of hard, you know. Let's say on tour for a month and you do the show every night and you hear whichever band you're touring with, and the last thing you want to put on is more of the same
more
kind
music.
Of music. Well, yeah, I think that's why I started to go back to this old rock music, because it's like giving me a relaxation,
kind of a balance.
Yeah, I think so. So no, I don't have that much time, and I don't know, somewhere along the way I lost the interest to explore that much, sadly. I'm quite envious of people who still have that, oh, you have to listen to this. I was like, no, sorry, I don't hear it because I'm not in the right mindset. It's not the band's fault, it's just I'm not in the right mindset to take in new expressions from people who are maybe doing similar things to myself, because I'm super fucking difficult to explain. But yeah, I can understand why people say that, and that applies to myself also. I tend to look back, and when I do have this moment, I'm gonna drive my car for an hour. Which album do I put on? Something that I know that I will like, or something that I may or may not like? So most likely I will take that The Mysterious Dom Satanas album to the car, you know? And that's just why, because I know it's convenient. Fucking old, no?
as a review guy, I mean, I literally go through hundreds of new albums every year.
Yeah.
And I must say, it's not always very, how to say nicely, it's not always a nice job, because you cannot put your hands so many times in turn.
Yeah.
So I feel like that, like, hey, I should just put some Slayer on, or some Mayhem, or Rimatsu. But then again, it's also quite refreshing. So the question would be, when you go and share a stage, for example, with some warm-up bands, how often you are like, hey, this band sounds quite okay on stage, I'm gonna check them out on whatever streaming service or CD?
Well, it happens. Most of the times when you have support bands, you are backstage preparing for your own show, so mm-hmm. there's rarely time to actually go check it out, which is sad in a way. Many times I would have wanted to, you know, have some extra time to do that, but it's tricky. And well, it has happened that you are backstage and you hear something that fucking this is good. I need to remember that. Sometimes I remember to do so, and other times I just forget about it. But yeah, I've discovered bands that way. Absolutely.
All right. Before we check out, so to speak, and let you go to do your dinner and stuff.
Yeah.
Whenever I talk to some bands that have been in the business quite a while, what I've learned is that many bands kind of they have changed their ways when they relax, and especially when we're talking about substances, they have changed, especially versus being 20s or even 30s. What is your way to relax, if you don't mind me asking?
Well, listen to all rock music. Nah, well, I don't know. I work out a lot because, you know, I'm not getting younger, so I need to do that shit. relax. What is relax? It's like a, no.
You like to keep yourself busy?
Yeah, I think I do that. I think I do that. Yes. So yeah, I had some time over last month, I think it was. So I got this idea to put a book out. For example, it's like
You mentioned that book. What we need to know about it?
Well, it's I haven't mentioned it anywhere yet, so you get the first dibs on it. But it's a photo book from travels, from tours, pictures I've taken myself from weird places, and it's some poetry in there also. Some like a coffee table book, if you will. I don't know how to explain it. So that's something that will be out also. So yeah, well, I have some spare time. I work anyway, but in a relaxing way, you know.
Any nervous feelings about how it will be taken, you know, in terms of reaction and all that?
No, I don't really care. I do it for myself. It's been something to occupy myself with, you know. Sometimes the journey is the target also. So if it's good, it's good. If it's bad, well, I don't really care because I want a copy for myself.
When it's going to be out?
Hopefully in April.
All right. If you had one tip or words of wisdom for a band that is about to start their gigging and touring career and do some albums, what kind of advice would you give?
Be yourself and have discipline.
What kind of discipline can you be more exact?
At the rehearsal place.
All right. Thank you for your time.
Thanks, man.
Nice answers. So once again, be sure to check out these guys, be alive, how they are on stage, and obviously listen to those records. You're gonna miss a huge portion of old Swedish traditional black metal in case you're gonna miss these guys. So, like I have been saying for many, many times, do your homework and don't miss that important shit. This is Rauta, and once again, have a good night there. And in case you wanna see more of these interviews coming up, be sure to check out our Patreon page for some, you know, nice funding and all that stuff. Anyway, Rauta, bye, bye. Thank you so much.
Thanks, man.
Like I said, I could have been talking for a few hours, but I knew the clock was ticking.